happy to be here today. Before I get started, I want to talk a little bit about our program. Cornell's Cooperative Extension Pesticide Management Education Program is designated by the state to provide pesticide safety education to New Yorkers. Our program mission is to promote sound decision-making and proper handling practices by people who choose to use pesticides. And we do that by developing training manuals for applicators, providing live and online training, and publishing crop and pest management guidelines, and answering questions from anybody about pesticides. One thing our program does not do is make specific pesticide product recommendations. Instead, we teach people how to determine what pesticide will best suit their needs, which we'll all be doing today. And to make sure we all start on the same page, I want to clarify the terms pest and pesticide, because a lot of people think they just refer to insects. But a pest is actually any living thing that has an undesirable impact on something that's important to us. So while some insects are pests, so are weeds, plants, rodents, and disease-causing bacteria and viruses. And any given pesticide is designed to control certain pests. So before you go out and buy one, you have to make sure you positively identify the pests. Here are the different types of pesticides we often use. For some reason, I didn't scroll when I did that, but so you can see even like the sanitizers and disinfectants we used this past year are pesticides. So you have to identify the target pest to make sure the pesticide will work. If you misidentify the pest, you'll probably select the wrong pesticide and it won't work, which means you'll be not only wasting money, but the pest problem will continue to worsen and you'll pose unnecessary risk to you and the environment. I say unnecessary because if there's no benefit involved, then the risk is definitely unnecessary. So once you've positively identified the pest and determined that using a pesticide fits within your overall integrated pest management plan, you head to your local hardware store and your eyes just glaze over. There's aisles and shelves of all these different pesticide brand names, container types and sizes, formulations. And sadly, the nice people in the orange vests usually aren't much help, to be honest with you. So how do you go about deciding which product is the one you should use? Well, a lot goes into that decision, but fortunately, the best piece of information to help you is right there in front of you, and that's the pesticide label. This is the information printed on or attached to the container when you buy the product. And it has all the information you need to use the product correctly and effectively to control a pest while protecting people and the environment. And you'll notice in the directions for use, it says the label is the law. Well, what does that mean? It means you can only use it as described on the label. If it's for outdoor use only, you can't use it indoors. If it says to use 1 ounce per 1,000 square feet, you can't use 2 ounces. Okay, you have to follow the labels for your own protection. Okay, so now you're back in that, you're there in the hardware store, you've got a container in hand. How do you know if it's right for you? Well, consider buying a product only if you look at the label and can answer yes to 7 questions. If any of these are a no, put it back on the shelf and look at something else. Question 1, is the target pest on the label for the intended site of application? If you're like me, you have Japanese beetles chomping on your rhubarb leaves and bean leaves in the garden, you might decide you need a pesticide to help control that. This label, as you can see at the bottom, is labeled for Japanese beetle adults, but only in lawns. It's not labeled for some vegetables, you can't use it. Pesticides meant to be used on food plants are held to a higher standard than this pesticide is, so the food might not be safe to eat it if you use this pesticide. Will it control the right life stage of the pest? Here's an insecticide that's labeled for those 10 caterpillars we all hate on our crabapple and apple trees in the spring. You need to apply it soon after the caterpillars hatch. Once they grow a bit, the product will no longer be effective. It simply won't work. Can you apply the pesticide when you need it? Okay, this fungicide label says don't spray plants during extremely hot and sunny weather. The labels of pesticides applied to vegetables often have what's called a pre-harvest interval, the number of days to wait between the last application and harvest. This allows enough time for the pesticide to break down, so when you do eat the plant, it's okay to eat. Are you willing and able to abide by all application restrictions? These are pretty standard use restrictions on the pesticide label for an indoor use. You'd have no problem with them, but what if it said you can't go back in for 4 hours after application? That might be a problem, so you might look for something else. Do you have or will you buy the necessary equipment needed to use the pesticide properly? Suppose you buy a concentrate pesticide, a liquid, and you have to mix it, okay? You're gonna want a measuring cup. You're gonna want to buy a separate one and write the word pesticides on it so you never accidentally use it in the kitchen. You'll need to get the proper sprayer. If the label says to wear waterproof gloves or goggles to reduce exposure, you have to, so you'll need to buy those as well. Is the product practical to use? This handheld pump spray bottle of weed killer would be great for, you know, weeds that pop up in cracks in the sidewalk or patio. Not the option of choice if you're doing a whole lawn treatment. And while we've all been busy using disinfectant wipes in the past year, hopefully you've looked at the label and noticed that a quick wipe of a doorknob won't kill a virus. The surface has to remain wet for a certain amount of time. All things being equal, looking at these two products, one on the bottom might be more practical for you to use because you only have to leave the surface wet for 4 minutes. You'll probably still need more than one wipe to do it, but it might be more practical for you to use. And finally, did you read the entire label? Everything I've shown you so far is stuff you find on the label, plus what I'll talk about, you know, later on. The issue is a lot of products now, because there's so much information they want you to have, might not fit all on the container, so they attached the label to the back. It's usually a little packet you have to peel back to look at the label. Don't be afraid to do that in the store. Okay, it's very easy. You peel the thing back, you unfold the label, it's easy to fold it back and put it back. Okay, it's not a problem. And it's important, even if you think you recognize the product, because there's an issue I want to talk about branding, why it's important to read the entire label. I like Special K. You go in the cereal aisle of the store now, there's like 7 different Special K cereals. Most of them I think taste terrible. I like the original, but they're all sold under the brand name Special K. And manufacturers do the same thing with pesticides. They sell very different products under common brand names. So one example is Roundup. Here we have the original. It contains the herbicide active ingredient glyphosate, which will kill any green plant you spray with it, but it has no residual activity. So the label says you can use it to prepare an area for a vegetable garden and then plant a day or two later. Can't remember exactly what the label says, but it's a short time after you can plant. Whereas Roundup Easy Mix, a different product, has a second herbicide active ingredient. And this label says you can't use it to prep a vegetable garden. And Roundup Landscape Weed Preventer doesn't even have glyphosate in it. It has a selective herbicide active ingredient so that you can spray your ornamental beds and kill the weeds without killing the desirable plants. If you use one of these other two by mistake, you're not going to be happy. There's even Roundup insecticide now. So you really need to open up that packet label and read it. Another good example is all the different mosquito repellents that have off in the brand name. They might have different active ingredients, work for different length of time, things like that. And one thing you notice that they can all be used on children. Only adults can apply them to children, by the way. Don't let children use them themselves. For the products shown here, only the one that says off botanicals has the statement that you can't use it on children under 3 years of age. That might surprise you given the word botanicals in the name, but it's just a reminder that natural does not always mean safer, okay? Risk depends on the chemical and how it's being used. So if you've looked at a product and you've answered yes to all those questions, you're good to go. That's all it takes. But you might have found two that you answered yes to. You might want to choose which one is best. So I'm going to give you some tips on that. These aren't yes, no, like the first set of questions. These are just things to consider to find out which one might best suit your needs. Okay, you can consider looking for an EPA registration number. That will be either near the ingredient statement or near the company information. Pesticides that have been registered by the EPA have gone through rigorous testing to make sure they'll work as stated, and also that when used according to label directions, they won't cause unreasonable adverse effects to people or the environment. There are some pesticide products that they meet specific requirements that are exempt from registration because the risk is presumed to be low, but you don't have independent testing as to whether they work, and there's nothing we know about the risk they actually pose for the use that's being marketed. So that's just something to consider. I'm not saying not to buy those other products, but it's just something to consider. And you'll want to consider which one poses less risk. you know, while I just said every registered pesticide should not pose any unreasonable risk when used according to label directions, we all know accidents happen. Plus, what you consider acceptable risk will depend on circumstances. For example, if a product says it's aquatic, toxic to aquatic invertebrates, that's not going to bother me here at home because I have landlocked property. But our family has a little camp on a lake up north. I might not want to use it there. So you have to do what you can to minimize risk, which is the likelihood to cause harm. It depends on two things: the toxicity or hazard, which is the pesticide's inherent ability to cause harm, and exposure, the extent to which a pesticide gets in or on your body or contacts some non-target plant or animal. So any chemical can be toxic or pose a hazard at some level of exposure. But if you can avoid exposure, even a highly toxic pesticide is unlikely to harm you. So what this means is least toxic does not equal least risk. You need to consider both of these factors. So if you want to assess risk to people, a great tool is the signal word that's on the front panel of the label. This indicates the relative toxicity. Danger, it's highly toxic or corrosive to skin or eyes. Warning, moderately toxic. Caution, slightly toxic. If there's no signal word, it means it's relatively non-toxic. There'll also be precautionary statements on the label, easy to find, telling what routes of exposure might be a concern and how to avoid that type of exposure. And for, you know, assessing exposure itself, just think about how the product is used. A ready-to-use spray might pose less chance of exposure because you don't have to mix it. There's less chance of spilling or splashing. And if you get dilute pesticide on your skin, there's lower exposure than if you spill concentrate pesticide on your skin. Baits or crack and crevice sprays are designed to be put exactly where the pest is, less likely an area where you might be touching, as opposed to a spray that maybe you have to apply to exposed surfaces. If it only needs one or two applications, that might result in less exposure than something that needs frequent reapplication. And if you follow label precautions, there will be less exposure because you'll only put the pesticide where you're supposed to, not places you're not supposed to put it. You'll only be using the amount you're supposed to use, not too much. You'll be wearing gloves if necessary to protect yourself. You won't let people into the treated area until the proper time, things like that. And imposing less risk to the environment, very similar. Look at the label. If it poses a hazard such as toxic to bees or highly water soluble and prone to water runoff, leaving the site and going to surface water, the label will tell you that. If those hazards exist, it'll tell you how to avoid them. So you take this into account for what your particular situation is. You can consider which one works for the necessary length of time. Mosquito repellents don't all work for the same length. Some, you know, 2 hours, some will work for 10 hours. Some might tell you to reapply them after swimming. And then you want to consider which one is available in a reasonable amount. Cheaper is not always better. So use an example of you have some dandelions in your lawn, not enough to do a whole lawn treatment, but you want to spot treat some weeds. And let's say for some reason, digging just doesn't work for you. So here's two products are basically identical, except the one on the left is the concentrate that you have to take home and dilute. And the one on the right is already diluted for you, it's ready to use. Well, the concentrate costs less and it's only one quart, so you might think, I'll just get that. But if you notice, it says it treats up to 16,000 square feet. Now, if you're spot treating weeds, that's basically 16,000 weeds. So do you have that many weeds you're spot treating? Probably not. So you're gonna be left with a lot of leftover concentrate you can't simply throw in the trash. You're gonna have to find some way of disposing of it. Okay, so that's what you do in the store. It's really not that hard. What about buying pesticides online? You have to be a little bit more diligent here because a lot of online retailers will say, okay, we'll sell you this pesticide, but they don't show you the label. And so you already know from step one, if you can't read the whole label, don't even consider buying the product. So you wanna make sure you can see the label online first. And then look for the EPA registration number. This is very important for online sales because online retailers have been found to sell illegal and dangerous, and I do mean dangerous chemicals, sometimes posing as pesticides, okay? So you wanna look for that EPA registration number. And if you're here in New York State, you can go to this website and plug in the name of the product and that EPA registration number you found to make sure you can use it here. the Department of Environmental Conservation puts EPA registered products through New York's own registration process in collaboration with the Department of Health to make sure they're protecting your health and New York's unique environmental resources. So an online retailer might not realize the DEC has said, no, you can't use that EPA registered product here in New York. Or maybe you can, but not on Long Island. Or maybe it can be used, but only by certified applicators, so you can't legally purchase it. Okay, DECs, they have a lot of reasons for putting on these restrictions to protect you and the environment. So I encourage you to use the site. If you have any questions navigating it, feel free to contact the DEC or our program. We'll be happy to help you. And I want to close with a comment about home remedies for pest control. You'll see recipes for these online, newspapers and magazines, even local newscasts. And while, the people who make these recommendations are usually well-intentioned, but they'll make claims such as chemical-free, pesticide-free, non-toxic, all-natural, effective, and safe. The reality is, everything is made of chemicals. A chemical that controls pests is a pesticide, whether you buy it in a store or mix it up at home in your sink. If a chemical is killing something, that's a pretty good indication that it might be toxic. And a lot of them require you to use man-made products. There might be stuff you normally use around the home, but still man-made. And as I mentioned before, all natural does not necessarily mean safer. It's how you use the product. Okay, your kid might like hot sauce on their buffalo wings, but you're not gonna let them play with a canister of pepper spray, right? It's the same chemical, folks. So it's how a chemical you use it matters. The effectiveness is untested. You have some guy named Fred typing up on Facebook, hey, I use this, and that's not really the best recommendation for if something's gonna work. And the safety is untested as well. And looking at these chemical recipes, I can tell that a lot of them are demonstrably unsafe. For example, a lot tell you to use dish soap to make a spray for vegetable plants. And dish soap is not safe to ingest. The CDC spent a lot of time last year telling people don't wash your produce in dish soap to get rid of the virus. It's not safe. And any chemical poses risk, as I said, but with home remedies, you don't have a label telling you what the hazards are and how to avoid them. So my advice to you, and actually my plea after doing this for 30 plus years, is to leave the chemistry experiments and safety testing to the experts. Remember the DEC and Department of Health have your back. They're working to protect you and the environment. And I've shown you how easy it is to select a pesticide that will get the job done, that will be upfront about what hazards exist and how you can avoid them. So stick with things you can buy in the store, please. And I guess that's it. For more information, we have a website here where we have one-page fact sheets that have a lot of the information I talked about here today. And there's my email down at the bottom if anybody has any questions. I guess that's where we are.
Great. Well, thank you, Dan. I think it's really great perspective for people, because when you do walk into the big box store, it's overwhelming to see that huge variety of products. So knowing that we have a few key things to look at as we select a product is really helpful. Let's see. So we didn't have any direct questions come in. We had a different brochure that was submitted to help you when you're shopping for products. That's a DEC brochure.
Okay.
So we'll definitely take a look at that and include that in our resources. If anybody does have a question, you can certainly continue to type those into the chat. I guess at this point, maybe we'll transition to our IPM minute and then have people type questions and we can respond to that after. So
I'll stop sharing now.
Yes. Okay. And actually, so as we transition here, somebody did ask, what is your go-to for Japanese beetles, since you did mention them?
Well, again, we don't make specific pesticide recommendations. My go-to is honestly give up. we just knock them off the plant, get them in a jar, and then the foot works from there. that's kind of what I do with them. You knock them into a jar of water and let them drown there, or just stomp on them. But yeah, we don't make specific pesticide recommendations. I would send you to the IPM program for recommendations on how to control things.
Thanks, Dan.
So do I stop sharing it or no?
You
unshared
control from you. Yep.
All right. Thank you.
Let's see. And we do have another question that came in. So why can't they put labels on internet ads? Why can't they put labels of pesticides on internet ads? That would be a great help. So I guess that's for the, advertising online or on television.
Yeah, they can. There are some sites that will do it. Some sites don't. So that's why my advice is don't buy online if they don't provide you a copy of the label right there to look at.
Great. All right. So I'll transition now to the IPM Minute, which I will be providing today. It's kind of a follow-up to our previous presentation, which was on knocking down early season stinging insect nests. So today we'll talk a little bit about yellow jacket trapping to catch fall wasps. And the first thing that I want to point out is that wasp behavior changes in the fall due to a collapse in the social structure of the nest. In the fall, the colony has peaked in size and productivity. The queens and males that were produced later in the season have left, and the queen that was responsible for developing that nest has died. So the yellow jackets in that colony are seeking sweet food sources to sort of sustain themselves, but it's the end of their life cycle, and they are acting in a way that we perceive as aggressive, but it's not that these insects are actively trying to sting you. They're not, intentionally being that way. They're hungry. They may be looking for natural food sources. And this could be honeydew from plant feeding insects, whether it's aphids. And the image on the left shows honeydew on leaves. This is actually from a spotted lanternfly introduction where the insects are excreting a sweet substance as they feed on the plant juices. And that's attractive to stinging insects. They may be also attracted to human food sources, whether it's a garbage can that has food spillage on it, or if it's at your picnic or when you go apple picking. All of these food sources that are sweet in nature are attractive to these yellow jackets. So one of the things that we like to recommend to people to reduce the numbers that are sort of in the space where people are trying to enjoy outdoor activities is to use traps. And these can be made at home on your own, or they can be purchased online. So these are baited with soda, fruit juice, or something else to attract the insects and nothing else. Insects get to the trap, they get stuck inside the device, and they ultimately succumb to drowning within that device. So today, I just wanted to show you a real quick technique for making a simple bottle trap. And this is something that you can use in an area where you're trying to enjoy that outdoor activity, maybe around a picnic or an outdoor barbecue. Start with a bottle and cut these small X-shaped openings into the side. You want to do it on three sides so that there is a side for you to pour liquid into. You want to use a knife to create that first incision. And if you can see here in the picture, I'm cutting away from myself so that I don't have a higher risk of injuring myself. And then you can use scissors to open the other flaps. You want to adjust the opening size so that it's large enough for the insects to get in, but not, not a gaping hole. And then you want to put that in an outdoor area. A few quick tips. First, if you are encountering yellow jackets and you want to flick them away, you can use a fly swatter. Don't use your hand. Anytime you swat an insect that can sting, you could potentially be stung. So flick them or swat them with a device. And if you do get stung, it's best to run for cover because there are alarm pheromones produced by many stinging insects that live in colonies. So they can sort of mob you. And this is what happened to me and our dog, is that I got stung and then the dog got stung because we were right near the yellow jacket nest. So if stung, run for cover. We have a ton of resources on bees and wasps and some great YouTube videos about stinging insect management. So feel free to visit our YouTube channel and look for the bees and wasps YouTube playlist. So with that, I will stop sharing. I don't see any additional questions having come in at this time. So unless we get another question within the next minute or so, we would like to thank you for attending today and your participation. Again, a recording of this video will be placed on our YouTube channel after we've edited the the caption, and so that will be available. We can put the YouTube channel for Bees and Wasps into the chat. And let's see, so we did have one question that we can answer in the last minute. From how far away can yellow jackets sense a trap? So that's a good question. These insects this time of year are kind of foraging all about looking for potential sweet food sources. So I don't know the exact distance. We do have some experts on the call. Jody may be able to chime in, but they are foraging over great distances to find these resources. Just recently, if you have hummingbird feeders, you may see activity on them now. Bald-faced hornets and yellow jackets are visiting these sites. So it could be a mile or more that these insects are looking for food resources. Let's see, another comment here. Remind people that they are only to apply pesticide products on their own property. So that's a great comment by Luann, is that if you're going to apply a product, it has to be on the property that you own. And Dan may be able to provide additional comments to this. But any pesticide applications that are made on someone else's property would require a pesticide applicator's license to do so. So Dan, I don't know if you'd like to chime in here.
That's correct.
Okay, great. And yeah, so we are at 12:30. So in the essence of time, I will cut us off here. Amara did post a link to the Bees and Wasps YouTube playlist, so you can access that to review additional information. So thank you again, Dan, for a great presentation. And thank you, everybody, for attending. We hope you have a great weekend.
Okay. Thanks, Matt.